We don't believe in Grenada in presidents for life or elected people for life. We believe in service for life. And when you stop serving, you must be recalled and get out of the way for somebody else to serve. There is a need for some kind of mechanism to be established. In the face of all of the difficulties, in the face of all of the economic destabilization, the political, diplomatic, and military threats and pressure, we don't intend to roll over and play like an ostrich.
The Joint Chiefs worked around the clock to come up with a plan.
In these times, it is becoming more and more difficult for developing third world countries to go forward. The massive cuts in social welfare, the cuts are not coming in the arms race. The cuts are not coming out of the arms budget. I understand the talk is to spend $3 trillion over 5 years. The mind boggles. In the developing world as a whole, it is now estimated that our debts exceed $650 billion. We are also discovering that it is becoming more and more difficult to engage in trade with the countries of the Western industrialized world. What they have now done after cutting off aid, cutting off trade, cutting off investment, making it virtually impossible to get money through the international financial institutions, now they are forcing more and more third world countries to go directly to the international capital market, to the big commercial banks, to get loans. But the reality is that by forcing us more and more to have to go to the international capital market, the debt trap is intensified even more.
In 1979, trouble came to Grenada. Maurice Bishop, a protege of Fidel Castro, staged a military coup and overthrew the government which had been elected under the Constitution left to the people by the British.
We are able to mobilize and organize the people to cut out waste, cut out corruption, to stamp on inefficiency, to move to planning, to look out for production, to check on productivity, to make sure that state enterprises are not set up to be subsidized, but that state enterprises too must become viable, must make a profit. The money that the people of Grenada used to have to spend, for example, when they went to a doctor or a dentist, that money they no longer have to spend because they now have free health care throughout the system. They understand that when 37 cents out of every dollar is spent on health and education, that means something. Our people understand the value and the benefit of free secondary education, because they know now that once their children are able to pass the common entrance exam and get into secondary school, they no longer have to worry about finding those fees, which, as you know, for agricultural workers, for example, were very often impossible. But not just free secondary education, but in effect free university education.
Joined by Jamaica and Barbados, had sent an urgent request that we join them in a military operation to restore order and democracy to Grenada.
Moving from a situation before the revolution, where in the last year of Gary, 1978, just 3 people went abroad on university scholarships, and they happened to be Gary's daughter and one of his other minister's daughter. Moving from that situation, in the first 6 months of the revolution, 109 students were able to go abroad on free university scholarships.
The Joint Chiefs worked around the clock to come up with a plan.
When they say to us that elections must be held, and if you don't have elections, then you can't expect support. And unless you have elections, then we can't give you the normal treatment. We say, when the Americans had their revolution in 1776, it took them 13 years to call their election. They talk about detainees, but when the American Revolution came in 1776, thousands were locked up without charge or trial. Hundreds were shot. And the counter-revolutionaries after the American Revolution, they had no right to vote. They had no right to teach. They had no right to preach. They had no right to a job. Their land was confiscated without payment. So when the falsifiers of history try to pretend that the American Revolution was a Boston Tea Party, was a very bloody Tea Party.
He sought the help of Cuba in building an airport, which he claimed was for tourist trade, but which looked suspiciously suitable for military aircraft, including Soviet-built long-range bombers.
So when these elements come and make these statements, we understand only too well where they are coming from. They understand that in Grenada, no one is ever interfered with for what he says. No one is ever interfered with for what he writes. Because to us, democracy is much, much more than just an election. To us, democracy is a great deal more than just the right to put an X next to Tweedledum name or Tweedledee name every 5 years. We don't believe in Grenada in presidents for life or elected people for life. We believe in service for life.
We had to assume that several hundred Cubans working on the airport could be military reserves. And we have discovered a complete base with weapons and communications equipment, which makes it clear a Cuban occupation of the island had been planned.
But these people have also thrown out another allegation against Grenada. This other allegation concerns the question of our international airport project. This one is, of course, the most comical one of all. According to the formulators of this famous theory, Grenada's international airport is now going to become a military base and will now become a strategic jump-off point from where we can launch an attack on the great, big, powerful, mighty United States.
It was a Soviet-Cuban colony being readied as a major military bastion to export terror and undermine democracy.
This airport is an ancient dream of the people of our country. This international airport has undergone a quarter century of studies. All previous governments from 1955 have spoken about the need for the airport. And if you understand the situation in our country, that would be no surprise to anybody. The present airport is called Pearls. Pearls has a strip 5,500 feet long. That means only little turboprop planes can come in.
On October 12th, a small group in his militia seized him and put him under arrest. He and several members of his cabinet were subsequently executed.
The question of the length of the strip, the basis on which we had to make a strip of 9,000 feet, is because all of the manuals that were done by European and American companies. I can think of McDonnell Douglas, people who do the DC-8 and so on. I can think of the Boeings. They have produced manuals saying what length of strip is required if their planes are to land. So unless we born big and stupid, you can't expect us to put down a strip that planes that can carry people, normal jet planes, won't be able to use. So the fact of the matter is the 9,000 feet was dictated by the necessity for that. This international project, as we see it, is the gateway to our future. As we see it, it is what alone can give us the potential for economic takeoff. As we see it, can help us to develop the tourist industry more, can help us to develop our agro-industries more, can help us to export our fresh fruits and vegetables better. But last month, 6.5 months ahead of schedule, we announced to our people what the name of next year will be, so they can start from now to mobilize, including mobilizing overseas around the name, because 1984 next year will be called the year of the International Airport.